I find it odd, really odd, that Warner Brothers would allow DC Universe to tell a Harley Quinn breaks up with Joker story right before Margot Robbie tells her. In fact, Margot Robbie at one point was going to voice Harley here. And I think it would have been bad for us if she did, because Kaley Cuoco is a revelation. But I think it would have been better for Margot Robbie, because again, Kaley Cuoco is a revelation. That's right, making things even more complicated is that there is no way Birds of Prey is as good as this show. Even if Birds of Prey is a good movie, you just can't compete with how much more time the Harley Quinn animated series has to tell this story. Also, because it's animation, they have an incredible budget to be able to show so many villains and have them use superpowers and do so many great stuff and go to so many different locations. It's amazing. I love the show so much, if you can't tell already. I would describe Harley Quinn the animated series as, wait for it, Batman the animated series meets Glow meets the Venture Brothers. I know. I loved the Venture Brothers. I miss it dearly. And this will certainly scratch that itch for you. And your DC itch at the same time. It's so great. This is the best depiction of the Joker-Harley Quinn breakup I have ever seen. I finally get it. Yes, I read the comics. I watched some of the animation that also depicts the breakup or deals with it. But I never have felt it was a good idea to separate Harley from the Joker, to make her her own independent woman. I was like, that's not what Harley's about. She's the poster woman for abusive relationships. However, and I mean, I know that's a horrible fate, but I think it's important to have that out there. There are so many female characters. This is what Harley has represented. And I think it's been good for women to see that and be like, I don't want to be that, right? The message has been gotten lost a little bit, right? With people being like, I'd love to be that. And you're like, whoa, don't romanticize that. But so that's another reason that this is good. It takes these fabulous characters and takes them on a healthy, interesting journey that you can go along with. Yes, as I said, this is a journey. It's 13 30-minute episodes. So good. I wish I had more. And both Harley and Joker are very well portrayed, by the way. And also some of the times that they've depicted the Harley-Joker breakup, they've really thrown Joker under the bus. And I feel very disrespectful of the character. Not the case here. I think they both come out very strongly. And I absolutely love now the evolution of the Harley Quinn character. And I think it benefits both her and Joker. It's fun. It's funny. It's so funny. And wow, does it get what women go through both personally and professionally. Now, some of you might be like, barf, but I'm telling you, it's done in a way that's accessible and enjoyable to everyone. And here's what's also interesting. This show is mostly written and produced, and it's created by men. A whole bunch of guys made this. So I can't believe how in tune they are with how women think. There are some women writers on the show, to be fair. But I think that having that male perspective, but the men wanting to tell this story to their credit, you get something that, again, is not only accessible to everyone, but I think is still entertaining. And also, I think it deals with breakups from the guy side, too. I think there are some really funny jokes. And sometimes I was like, if you were to hear some of the jokes here out of context, you'd be like, oh my God, that's so disrespectful and that's so horrible. But they're so funny here. And so I would actually liken it to a little bit of like the Dave Chappelle humor from his special. It's edgy. It sometimes crosses the line, but it's so well done, you can't help but laugh and respect it. It's really that good. I can't oversell this enough. My biggest fear is that you will not watch this show and that people won't talk about it because it's absolutely amazing. So I'm just very impressed that guys were able to get how women feel so right. In fact, sometimes watching this show as a woman, it was both shocking and hard to watch because it was just so on target. You were like, whoa, I've been there. Oh my God. All right, now speaking of relationships, I have to tell you there is no LGBT vibe between Harley and Ivy. Ivy even has her own fascinating alpha female beta male romance with Kite Man. I really liked that development a lot. It was great. It came out of nowhere, but I loved it. The lack of LGBT flirtation is bound to disappoint many fans, though, especially since it's now canon in the comics and the animation, with even co-creator Paul Dini, saying that was always his intention when he first paired up the two characters. But again, I think because both Harley's toxic relationship and Ivy's modern career woman relationship are so incredibly well realized, plus, Now I find myself on the other side of the Stucky argument, right? It's nice to see a great platonic female friendship. Oh, I get it. I get the hypocrisy. Okay? I get you guys who say, like, Cap and Bucky are just really good friends. But there's always a kid. There's a vibe there. There's a vibe there. But having watched the show, I paid attention to it because I know how important it is to fans of Harley and Ivy's LGBT relationship, and I know that it's canon. I was looking to see if it was there. It's not there. There's no hint. It's not there at all in this show. And again, I know that will disappoint some people, but I hope that you'll realize that even though we lose that, which is a shame, but it exists other places, you get so much good stuff here that I think the trade-off is okay. Now, that's the glow part of the show. I also mentioned Venture Brothers, because the Legion of Doom totally gets the Guild of Calamitous Intent treatment here, and it is just as hilarious. Wow, getting an inside look at Batman's rogues gallery and DC villains overall is an absolute joy. And to see Batman and Jim Gordon and other heroes from Harley's and the other villains' perspective, oh, I just loved it. And boy, what they do, for instance, Jacob Tremblay voices Damian Wayne. And I, as you know, I am a huge Damian Wayne fan, and they were so disrespectful to Damian Wayne, but I loved it, because again, it was just so incredibly clever. Yes, no DC character is safe on this show. They're also incredibly disrespectful of Jim Gordon, but I loved it. And it features super hard R violence, language, and sexual innuendo. Even Deadpool, you know, there's some talk that they're trying to, DC's trying to turn Harley into their female Deadpool. Even Deadpool, I've never seen the character go quite this far in every category, right? And I'm happy to say that Harley never breaks the fourth wall on, I don't believe she ever broke the fourth wall on this show, which I think she doesn't need to. And I think it keeps her being her own character. I don't want her to be the female Deadpool. I think she's above it. I think let them have their own spaces. They've carved them out. This show, again, it's so damn clever, so insightful, and it so gets the source material. It has fun with it, but it does it effectively, and it's so good and so funny because it gets what it's making jokes about. It's just a joy to watch. Oh, for instance, Dr. Psycho uses the C word while fighting Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman looks so cool on this show. I wish that was more of her. But he uses the C word, and while that sounds like it would be in very bad taste, when you see how it's handled throughout the season, both for comedy and for story-wise, and the callbacks on this show and so many different cases are insane. So good that, again, you will tip your hat to this show. I thought, if you told me you were going to have Dr. Psycho use the C word to describe Wonder Woman, I would be like, I don't like that. But now that I've seen how it's done, I love it. I can't believe I'm saying it. I love it. Everyone's so good. Some of the episodes in the third act do lag a little bit when things get a bit too zany and are the most like the wildly uneven Harley Quinn comic. But I have to say, the Harley Quinn comic led to this, so I have to give it credit for that, and I will always kind of like it even more a little bit for that. But thankfully, that's really only one or two episodes in an otherwise incredibly strong season. It has a heck of a cliffhanger ending. Such a good cliffhanger ending. I'm like, are you kidding me? Oh my God, give me season two now. Stupidly though, DC Universe will be releasing this weekly. I mean, I know they want to keep you subscribed, but it's so dumb. This show is meant to be binged. I binged it in 24 hours. I would have watched it straight through if I could have done it. I had professional and personal obligations, so I couldn't. But I have to tell you, I was distracted through most of them because I just was like, I gotta get back to this show. I couldn't stop watching it. I love the little touches. For instance, they have that DC intro, but here they play different opening music every time to set the mood for the opening scene. And it always went so cool with the DC opening. Sometimes it was like very different. Sometimes it played in beautifully. I just thought it was so good. It was like, wow. I can't say enough good things about this show. As you can see, if it gets renewed for a second season, which it should, and again, because of that cliffhanger ending, I suspect that down the line, this will be a huge hit for HBO Max, and Warner Brothers should really get behind this show. This is, forget the best thing DC Universe has put out to date. Sorry, Doom Patrol fans. And, you know, I like Swamp Thing too. You know, what I saw of it, I stopped watching when they ridiculously canceled it. This is the best thing that, you know, it's up there with like Joker and Wonder Woman, the first Wonder Woman, in terms of what, and The Dark Knight, in terms of quality stuff that DC has, Warner Brothers DC has put out. And this has got to be a hit. It has to be. The voice cast here is as good as Batman the Animated Series and Venture Brothers. It's very much like Venture Brothers. Somebody watched Venture Brothers. Who didn't? Such a good show. Kaley Cuoco is Harley Quinn. Wow. Lake Bell, Poison Ivy, Tony Hale, I'm going to mispronounce a ton of names here, Ron Funches, Alan Tudyk, and J.B. Smoove is to round out the gang. Nonstop laughs. I hate Cy Borgman. I don't like the character. I think it's not funny. Jason Alexander does the voice, so that helps it a little bit, but it's the character is just as unfunny and useless as he is in the comic. I can't believe he made the... Luckily, they got rid of the stupid beaver jokes, which got into the Birds of Prey movie, unfortunately. But, you know, both those things should go away. Matt Oberg is Kite Man. Loved him. He made the character work so well. And again, even though he's the beta male to Ivy's alpha female, he maintained his respect and I think was really well portrayed. And the Legion of Doom. Considering how Lex rocks the bald look, he's actually a great candidate for race bending. And Giancarlo Esposito does a great job. Wow. Other standouts in the Legion of Doom are Jim Rash as the Riddler. Oh, the Riddler was great, especially in the opening episode. The things they made him say. Oh my gosh. But it was hilarious. James Adomian as a Tom Hardy-style Bane. Non-stop laughter. This character, you know, they made, he's a fun, he's there for jokes, but he just keeps giving and giving. I loved it. And then Rahul Kohli as Scarecrow. Love they did. Love they made him British. Great. All of these line readings, you just can't get better than this. Even the main characters. Everyone does such a good job. Now, Wanda Sykes, a true professional, always a treat. But I had mixed feelings about her Queen of Fables. To me, while well realized, she didn't really fit with the overall DC vibe. Even though, go figure, she is a DC character. Gail Simone created her. And some of the stuff Gail Simone did was great. Some of the stuff, to be honest, not so great. This was one of the not so great things. But boy, I can see what, you understand why she's in the show. I maybe would have preferred a different villain in that spot, but don't worry, it all works out in the end. So as I said, Batman the Animated Series meets Glow meets Venture Brothers, right? How can you not watch that? You gotta watch it. Don't miss it. It's worth the money to pay for this service. Even though it's, and you might say, oh, I'm gonna wait to binge it. Don't wait. You gotta watch it now. You gotta watch it as soon as it debuts on November 29th. You gotta watch it. Trust me, you will thank me. This is, you know what? This is the boys level. This is that good. You gotta watch it. All right, so that's my review of DC Universe's animated Harley Quinn show. Share your own thoughts down below. Subscribe today. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.